Hello again. We are back after a very short break. I'm Petrache Marin for those who missed my intro. And after a very good talk after the lunch, we have now another that is completing the picture, I would say. Basically, we have a programming cocktail. So Tiberiu Popovic is our next speaker. Before giving you a few details about TB, I have a surprise for him. So TB, take a look. Not sure how visible this is it, but this is a cocktail.
Okay.
And yeah, I will just try to make it visible. So this is special for you.
Well, what can I say? Thank you.
I will let's continue the introduction here. So I'll let you a few moments before you start. So I'd like to continue TB, prepare for us another type of cocktail. Yeah. So basically his is the perfect cocktail using React and unit test. A few things about TB before he start. So TB is one of our best colleagues. He's a team lead in our web community. He's developing application since 2003. Started with PHP, probably as many of us. And after that, continued the cocktail working with JavaScript and multiple frameworks on this part. He has vast experience creating B2B application, e-commerce shops, software as a service platforms, and high traffic apps. So don't forget to send us questions for TB during the presentation, and we'll address them at the end. TB, now you have the stage.
Okay, the floor is mine. Thanks for that amazing presentation. I couldn't have said it better myself. Okay, my presentation for today is called Create a Perfect Cocktail Using React and Unit Tests. And I have a small spoiler for you, because these are the things that we're gonna talk about today. So I'm kind of in the middle of my introduction. Then we're gonna talk about React and testing in React in general. Then we're gonna have a look at some examples of pure components, how to test them, add container components. Again, how can we test those? We're gonna have a little chat about snapshot tests, their advantages and disadvantages, testing hooks in React, and then some final thoughts based on my experience when working with React and unit tests in general. And then the highlight of this presentation, the Q&A session. It's when you get to ask your questions. Now, why cocktails, basically? During this lockdown, I think, the consumption of alcohol basically skyrocketed. And I'm no exception. And maybe out of boredom, I don't know, I've started to compare drinking alcohol and testing applications, more or less. So I kind of stretched the reality a little bit over there. And because when I try and create a new cocktail recipe, I extensively test each ingredient separately, because I have to know all the textures and the taste of each ingredient. So that kind of looks like unit testing, where in software development, you divide your code into small units of code that you actually get to test individually. And then when you're done writing your units of code and testing them, you combine them together, and then you start testing their integrations. Well, kind of the same when you're mixing drinks. You start mixing them and testing how they work together. Those are the parallels that I saw there between drinking and writing tests, I think. Now, in software development, you have different testing strategies, and those strategies differ from project to project. And you can also combine multiple strategies in order to feel confident of your changes. Now, that we saw the connection between drinking and testing, let's talk about React and unit testing in React. Now, this phrase, let's call it like that, it seems to apply even when drinking and generally when writing code. Just because you can make create some sort of weird bird out of a banana doesn't actually mean that you should. And just because you can create some weird code using React doesn't actually mean that you should. So what is React? In my opinion, my personal opinion, it's more like a glorified templating engine. But the general consensus seems to be that React is an unopinionated framework. What does that mean? It means that it doesn't care. It has no opinion on how you structure your code and your application, what libraries you use, and in general, how you write your code. Now, as opposed to, let's say, Angular, that has very strict rules about many of those things, yeah. React doesn't care. Just hands you some tools and you deal with those. That comes with a lot of freedom, right? Freedom to write code, however you see fit. And that can bring also a lot of bad practices, and you can easily end up with spaghetti code or with a weird word out of a banana. Now, this code always makes me chuckle because it's from a brochure that I got for my kids' kindergarten. And I don't know about you guys, but when I think about 10 kids in the same room, discipline is not really the word I have to describe that. But in this context, it kind of brings some value because that freedom, that liberty that React brings you must be followed by discipline, actually. Because if you don't have a plan, if you're not consistent, you cannot actually write easily testable applications. And I'm saying that because writing tests often begins before you're writing your code. And I'm not talking about test-driven development. That's really hard to do, and some projects are not actually suited for that kind of testing. My current project, for instance, isn't, because we're actually creating lots of prototypes. We're doing a lot of prototyping inside our project. So what the code you write today, tomorrow won't be valid anymore. But we do have to plan ahead, because when the final code actually gets written, we do write tests for that code. So we do have the liberty to choose the framework and the library that you're gonna use. You do have the liberty to decide what kind of testing are you gonna do in your code. But let's have a look at those libraries that you can use, right? Because I've listed in this slide some of them. Some I've used, some I've only looked at remotely, but it's just a handful of them, because there are lots more out there. And if there are so many of them, it's a jungle out there. How do you choose your testing framework or library? Well, the picture I've used in this slide actually gives us a clue. Because whenever I think of chess, I think of strategy. So it all depends on your testing strategy that you're using. So when you're writing the code, you have to divide those components into categories and decide what strategies are you going to apply for each of those components. And when I say strategies, I really do mean more, because in today's example, we're actually going to look at more strategies for the same component, right? So these are the three most common testing strategies that I've seen used with React. Unit testing allows us to isolate each component and test it independent of its children or of its parents. or everything outside it. And it has its benefits, but it also has some drawbacks. That the main drawback that I see is that you're writing a lot of code, or a lot of tests for a piece of code. As advantage, I would say it indicates very easily where the problem is, and we're going to see that in a moment. Now, another common testing strategy is the functional testing. This is applied when you're basically clicking a button and looking at how the interface changes. You don't actually care how that interface got there, how the changes come to be. It's actually a state change, it's a property change. You don't actually care about that. All you care is the input and the end result. And that also has lots of advantages, because it's easier to refactor your components, because you don't actually care about how exactly they work. You do care about what they do. Now, after all this, when you have a fairly complex app, you have multiple components that need to talk to each other. And for those, and you need to test that, how they interact. And those are the integration tests that you should apply. We're gonna have an example for each strategy during today's presentation. Now, we saw the strategies over there, and we saw the tools that you can choose, but as developers, we tend to stick with the tool that we choose more often. So if you're a guy that has a new hammer, we tend to treat everything as a nail. But depending on the kind of testing that you do, you maybe need two or three or more tools. So my advice to you is, don't stick with one tool. Just pick the best tool that you have for the job. Of course, you do have to keep in mind to limit the number of those tools, because you have to have a sweet spot over there. Because if you don't, using too many tools can become confusing and maybe hard to use. Now, let's have a small look at some of the most popular tools, I think, for testing with React. When you're rendering components in a browser, you're using the browser to render those components and to create a DOM. Now, when you're running tests, you don't have that luxury. So you need some sort of renderer over there. One of the most popular renderers out there is React Testing Library, that has this philosophy of testing the end result from the perspective of the user. So it's exactly what I said earlier. It doesn't care about how a change came to be. It just cares about the final change, the input and the output, and that's it. That's why it's better suited for functional and integration tests, right? The plus for that is that it's easier to refactor your code, right? Because you don't actually care about the logic of that component. You can change that. Now, with Enzyme, on the other hand, Enzyme allows you, Enzyme is another renderer for React, and it allows you to isolate your test component. And that's why it's better suited for unit tests. You can actually change, when you're testing with Enzyme, you can actually change properties and state, and also changes in interface. In order to use that those advantages, you must use the shallow rendering instead of mount. Shallow rendering basically allows you to separate the behavior of your component from the behavior of its children. They're not gonna influence you in that. Now that we had a look at the renderers, libraries, and strategies, let's have some examples. We're gonna look at pure components right now. So what are pure components? The term of pure component, it's actually derived from the term of pure function. A pure function is a function that has no side effects. For the same input, there's always the same output. What's a side effect, you might ask? Well, it's something that outside your function, right? So a closure might be a side effect. An AJAX call, so some asynchronous operation, is also a side effect. So it's a function that has none of this. In parallel, a pure component is actually a component that has no side effects, and for the same input, always generates the same output. So what's an input for a React component? Well, the input for React components is represented by properties and state. Because they have no side effects, they have less dependencies, external dependencies. So that's why they're easier to test and maintain. Because actually, when you're writing tests, you don't have to mock all the external dependencies because they have none. And they're easier to maintain from exactly the same reason, less external dependencies. Now, let's have a look at a simple test for a drop-down component. Let's call that component select. That component has a name, has some options, and has a non-change handler. On the left side of the screen, you'll see the default properties that we're going to use to render this component. So we have a name, we have an array of options, yeah, with the label and the value, and a mock function for the on-change event. These tests are written with Enzyme and Jest, and I've used Jest for all the tests. So basically right now I'm the guy with the hammer, with the new hammer. But I've done so in order for you guys to actually see better the differences, how these tests change. And I will point out where exactly it would be easier to use something else. Right. So let's have a look at our test. We are actually shallow rendering our select component using the default properties. We're using shallow render because we don't actually care about the children of this component. We don't care what they render. So shallow rendering is enough for us right now. Then we're going to find in the generated tree, we're looking for the element that has the class name select. And we're going to look at its properties, select the name, the data name property, and then we create our assertion that the rendered name is actually the name that we passed through default properties. Now, this is a simple test. It's nothing fancy about it. But after we've tested the name, let's have a look at the options. We need to test that our component actually renders the options that we pass down as parameters. Again, we shallow render the component because we don't care about how those options look. We care that they are present there. And after we shallow render our component, we search for the elements that have the class name of option. And we start making our assertions. Right, so the first assertion looks at the number of rendered options to be equal to the number of the options that we passed via default properties. And after that, for each option, it actually checks that the value and the label are correct. Again, pretty straightforward, nothing complicated over here. But then we start looking at some behavior. Right, because a dropdown must open when the user clicks it. Well, it must open the option list, right? So again, we shallow render our component. We search for the main element that has the select class, and then we create some assertions for the initial state. We look at that element to have the closed class name, but not the open class name. Right? So it's closed. Then we simulate a click. Then we update and refresh our component. And again, we create the appropriate assertion to look to see that the component is actually open. Now, as a matter of fact, this component uses internal state uses some sort of internal state to know if it's closed or open. But as you can see in this test, we're not actually looking for that state. We're not testing if the state has changed. We're actually testing the end result. We don't care how that end result actually got there. It might have been through a state change. It might have been through something else, right? Now, again, because that component changes state, the state changes are asynchronous, but over here in our test, we don't, there's nothing asynchronous over here. That's because you use that simulate function over there that comes with enzyme, and that helps us with the asynchronous state changes during a peak event, for instance. Okay, of course, this method can also be, this test can also be split into tests, one before the click and one after the click. So it's not actually a unit test, it's more like a functional test. But the logic is pretty simple, yeah? So you have a click handler that changes the state. If there's a problem somewhere in there, it's most likely gonna be pretty easy to find. So you're not gonna need a unit test to see exactly where the problem is. You can find it pretty easy. It's not that complicated. Now, the last test that we're gonna do with on our pure component, our dropdown component, is to see if it actually handles the change event. So again, we shallow render our component. We look for that main element. We create a mock for the change event, and then we simulate that event. After that, we're looking at our own change handler that we passed via default props to have been called exactly one time, and with the correct parameters. Now that's about it with pure components. As you can see, there's not a lot of test setup. There's not a lot of mocking that you have to do because it has no external dependencies. So they're pretty easy to test. And we have also applied two testing strategies for that small little component. Now, let's have a look at container components, because we use this type of components to isolate side effects. Some of you might say, okay, but we have hooks that we can use for that. And yeah, sort of, because in my developer career, I found out sometimes the hard way that completely separating these effects, the business logic from the presentation, will always generate a better code, a code that's easier to read, easier to maintain, and easier to test. When you're actually using hook, you're creating some sort of coupling over there, so they're not completely separated. That's why I am a big fan of hooks, but we have to choose the times when you use that, and it's sometimes better to use container components. Okay, so as I said, we use container components to isolate the side effects. That means that they have external dependencies, so they need a more complex setup process, and they're harder to refactor because of those dependencies, and that's pretty obvious. Okay, let's have a look at this list container. Again, it's pretty simple. Of course, it has some flaws, this container component, but it's enough for me to make a point over here. So in this container, we're actually using a custom hook called useReducer with thunk. It's a wrapper over the React useReducer hook. It allows us to dispatch actions from within action creators, sort of like Redux thunk, kind of the same. So we are having this useReducer with thunk hook to manage the state of this component. We have a use effect hook that has no dependencies. So it will run one time and one time only, emulating the component git mount lifecycle function. And then we render something based on the number of items that we have. So if it if you have some items, we render a list. If you don't have any items, we render a loader. Again, pretty simple list container. Now let's see what exactly can we test for this within this. So the first test, it displays the loader. It's extremely simple. Yeah, we shall render the list container, and we're looking for the loader component to be rendered. It's pretty similar to the test that we created for our pure component, right? But the second test, if we're looking in the second test, we're looking if the container actually dispatches the action to load the initial data. Now, as you can see over here, we're actually calling those external dependencies for our containers, so we have to mock them. So get data action, it's an action creator. We have to mock the return value for that. Use reducer with tank, our custom hook. We're gonna also mock the return value of that. And after that, we're gonna mount our list container. Now, as opposed to shallow rendering, mount actually runs the use effect hooks. Shallow, when you shallow render a component, it doesn't run the use effects hooks or the lifecycle methods. But in this case, we actually need to see if it dispatches on that use effect. So we're mounting our component. And after we mount our component, we create our assertions to see if the component actually dispatched the action that was returned by the get data action creator. Okay. We've seen that the component actually dispatches the action. Now let's look at how it renders a list of elements. And right now we're actually mocking again all the external dependencies, but this time we don't actually need to dispatch that that action on the component did mount lifecycle. So we shallow render our list container right after we've mocked all the values for the action creator and the use reducer with tank hook. And after we shallow render that container, we're actually looking at the list element and the properties that it receives. We don't care what the list element renders, because that should have its different test cases written for it, and it's another component, right? We're only testing the list container right now, so that's why we're shallow rendering it. Okay, so we tested the state, we tested that it dispatches the action, the proper action. We've also tested that it renders some elements. Now it's time to actually test the get data action creator, generator, sorry. So we know that get data action uses the get method, called the API. That get method is part of a proxy object. Instead of that proxy object, you can actually use your favorite HTTP library, like let's say Axios or something. Right, so we're mocking the data for that get method, and we're actually calling the get data action. Now, this is an asynchronous function, so we're using the async await method of calling this. And after we've called that action creator, we're gonna look at the get method and at the dispatch method to make sure that they have been called one time and one time only, and with the proper parameters. Of course, again, you can actually create two tests over here, one that tests if the get method was called, and one that tests if the dispatch method is called. But get data action is actually a function that has, I don't know, 5 lines of code. It's not that complicated. You can actually compress those into one single test case. And also, we do have assertions for each of those functions. So if an assertion fails, we actually know what function failed over there. Now, we've tested in our list container, we tested the initial state, we've tested the life cycle, the effect, basically. And we also tested the data fetching. We've tested all the units of code that we needed. But are we sure that everything works? Because we haven't actually tested the nuts and bolts, the glue that holds everything together. In order to do that, we actually have to write a test that runs the flow from start to end. And in order to do that, we're not going to mock now every external dependency. We're just going to mock the API call. And after we've written the mock for that API call, we're going to mount our component and then and let it run through its lifecycle, through its use reducer hooks, through everything, and look at the updates it does on the way. So after we've mounted our component, we create a bunch of assertions to make sure that the initial state is right. Yeah, so the loader is present, but the list isn't. And then we wait for the component to run through its lifecycle and create another set of assertions to actually test that the component rendered the correct list. Now, I must point out the act call over there. So we have that await act and then some promise with sit immediate. We need that because the effect that we're using in the list container is an asynchronous function, right? It's an API call that's asynchronous. And our component, our update, has to wait for that component to update its internal state, so for that call to return from the API. And in order to do that, we're using the act function. That's a function that comes from an external library called React Testing Utils, I believe. And we're telling that function, okay, you have to wait until this set immediate is run. Set immediate, for those of you who don't know, is a function that adds something at the end of the event loop. So that set immediate will run after every other callback runs. And that's okay. And after that set immediate is run, we actually update the rendering of our component. Now, this is actually kind of hackish. We're finding a solution for our component to wait the rendering. Over here, we'd be better off if we actually use React Testing Library, because React Testing Library does the exactly same thing, uses act internally, but it's actually transparent for me as a developer. I don't have to bother with all this nonsense over here with this hack. And it gives out a cleaner looking code, right? So maybe over here, React Testing Library is a better fit. Now that we've looked at container components, let's have a look at snapshot tests. What exactly are those and how do we use them? Snapshot tests are actually a JSON snapshot of what the component is actually rendering. And you take that JSON, you write it into a file, and the next time you run the test, you compare the output in the JSON format with the JSON in your file. If they match, everything's okay. If they don't match, something changed, so your test will fail. And that's pretty cool because it's a fast way of writing tests. It's simpler. Right? You don't have to search for specific elements in the tree for properties in the of those elements. You just generate a snapshot and you compare it. They're easy to update. It's easier to update that snapshot one time. You can make lots of changes and you just pass the update flag to Jest when you run your tests. All the changes will be updated. But it also, of course, it has some disadvantages because it produces lots of false negative runs. Basically, the the test will fail for every change that you make, no matter how trivial. Now let's have a look at the last test that we've written. Some of best practices when using snapshot tests. You should actually write snapshot tests that are deterministic. What does that mean? What does deterministic snapshot means? It actually means that you have to be able to determine what exactly the output of a component will be. Let's say, for instance, you have a component that outputs the current date. If you let that component calculate the current date internally, the output will change and you won't be actually able to predict that those changes. But if that component receives the current date via its properties, you have control over what that component will actually display. So you can determine the outcome. So the test, your actual snapshot won't actually fail. Now, another best practice is to treat snapshots as code. You have to keep them small enough. If you have a 4 pages long snapshot, a developer won't be able to actually look at the snapshot and see what changed or if there are any problems with that snapshot. And another one is use descriptive names for your tests. When you have lots of snapshots and lots of tests, you have to be able to match the snapshot that fails with a test that has to be fixed. So the more descriptive name, the better. Now let's have a look at the last unit test that we wrote and replace all those three assertions, the assertions that we make based on the React tree. Let's replace them with snapshots. So, as you can see, it's way cleaner, way easier to read. We're just rendering the wrapper and then comparing with the snapshot before and after the update. So yeah, it looks a lot better if you ask me. But on the other hand, for every small and trivial change, that snapshot will fail. Because if you're actually only changing the loading function or the loading text over there, it will fail, although the change is not important. It didn't change anything in the behavior of that component. It's only a minor change. On the other hand, this is not a deterministic test because our component should have received that string via its properties or by any other means. Not it should be hard-coded in that component. Okay, now let's have a look at testing hooks. This is the use reducer with func hook that we've used earlier. It's a basic example that you can find anywhere on the internet. Right, so it's just a wrapper over the use reducer hook present in React that only replaces the dispatch function with a custom dispatch that looks at the action that you provided. If that action is a function, it calls that function. If it's not, it just calls the original dispatch. So nothing very complicated over here. But let's see how we can test this. Well, first of all, our custom hook uses a React hook inside of it. When you're using React hook, you must use them inside of a component. If you don't use that hook inside a component, it will fail. The call to that hook, it will fail. It will give out an error. So we must not run the original use reducer hook. We must mock it. So that's what we do there with spyOn. Then we mock the return value of that use reducer hook. We create a mock of dispatch, and we also create an action that's actually a function, a mock function. And that's basically the setup. Now all that's left to do is to call the use reducer with func and use the custom dispatch method to dispatch our fake action. after we've done that, we create our assertions to see that the action was actually called because it's a mock function, and that it's been called with the proper parameters. Okay, so after all this, I only have to emphasize a couple of ideas. The first idea, it's actually from the beginning of our presentation, that you need to have planned. You need to think ahead when you're writing code. This is a practice that I've seen in many projects. You have a custom grid that internally uses a table, let's say from Ant Design, I don't know. What's important is that this custom grid adds a column, an actions column. It will be the column where you add the view and edit buttons, I guess. And the problem is that this component actually defines that action column inside of it. That component is defined inside of our custom grid, and there's no way that we can reach it from outside this component. I mean, I guess you could actually search for the table element, look at its properties, look at the value of column, get the first element of that, and in this way you could actually reach the actions column element and then create some sort of assertions over there. But it's highly coupled with our test is highly coupled with the output of this custom grid, and it's hard to read, hard to change, hard to anything. A better solution to this is to actually define that actions column outside of this component and import it as an external dependency for this, so you can actually test the right test for that column. Also, for the edit and view handlers, it's pretty much the same. You don't, if you're using them in that actions column and only there, you don't have access to them. You don't get to call them. So maybe these are supposed to be moved somewhere else. The logic for them, so that you can actually test them and access them. Now, the second thing I want to emphasize is a mistake that I've seen done in almost all the teams that I've worked. Almost every team that writes unit tests and I've worked with actually uses test coverage as a target. Test coverage is not a target, it's a tool. It's a tool that tells you what code runs when you run your tests. You can use this tool to see if you have to further isolate a component or a unit of code. And of course, you can use it to see what actually bits of code need more testing. But target on itself, it's not, test coverage in itself is not target. And that's because test coverage doesn't tell us anything about the quality of test. It only tells us that that code ran. It doesn't look at if you made any assertions to test that code. It just tells us it's run. And in turn, that gives us a false sense of security and confidence in your code base. Instead of using test coverage to measure the quality of your tests, measure the defects that are found in post-development. Right, so in the manual testing or in production phases of your cycle, release cycle, I guess. And with that, thank you. Now it's actually time for you guys to ask your questions.
Great presentation, TB. First of all, I have a confession to make. So I was not able to finish my cocktails because I was very absorbed by your presentation. So I guess your cocktail was better than mine, but next time I will try to be better. Yeah. So
thank you.
You're welcome. We have a question from the audience. So Vlad is asking, What's your experience with the frequency of a snapshot test failing because of a structural change in a component rather than an actual bug? In his experience, they were failing mostly because of that, and that created the bad habit of taking them lightly. Because of that, they become rather redundant.
Yeah, exactly. That's the main problem of snapshot testing. It's a great way. So snapshot tests are great if you don't have any tests at all and you need to actually write very fast some tests. But after you've done that, after that first phase, my advice is to go and replace them. Exactly because what Vlad was saying there, when the most that test will actually fail because of trivial changes. And when you see that failing, developers actually won't look at the reasons that test fails and will just update the test. And that kind of beats the purpose, right? They're great in the early stages of your project, but as time goes on, replace the snapshot tests with actual more on point tests.
Okay. I have also some questions. So we all know, of course, the tests are very important, right?
Right.
From your experience, how much effort you need to invest in to write tests? How are these impacting the final estimations? I don't know, do you have like a percentage or something like that? For example, from your experience, when I'm making some estimations and let's say I want to write unit tests as much as possible, how much time should I add to those estimations?
It's hard to say, basically, because if you're working on an existing code base, maybe it has already some tests. Maybe you have to change those tests. But let's take the case, the more simple case, where you're creating code from scratch. And I would double the time that it's, I think a good rule of thumb is double the initial estimation in order to write tests, proper tests. Of course, as time goes by, that time will decrease because when you already have lots of tests written inside your project, you're more confident of your code base, and then maybe you can actually lower the time. But from when starting a new project and a new code base, that would be double the time.
Okay, you mentioned about, let's say, writing tests on an existing application. And there are a few times when you don't just, let's say, write tests on an existing application, but you even rewrite the application itself.
Yeah.
So in this case, I don't know, are we able to reuse or adapt the existing tests to the new application? Is it hard? Is it recommended?
Well, it depends. As usual, the answer in programming is it depends. So if you're actually using the same technology, you could say reuse some of the tests, because I imagine that if you're rewriting the whole application, you're rewriting your data flows also, and the way everything combines, actually works together in your app, you might be able to use the logic of that test, of some tests for your new application, because you see your business logic won't actually change. It will change the way things are done, the order in which things are done, but the main logic will be there. So that I think you could be reusing. But let's say that if you completely change the technology. So right now, if you have a React application and then you decide, I want to rewrite it using Angular, then I don't actually see how you could actually keep the tests. Yeah, you could keep them around for you to get inspired on how to write the new tests and see the test cases that you've used. But yeah, right, you would have to write them from scratch.
Okay. And I have one more final question from me. And this is a case that it happens to me a few times with our clients. So let's say we have a very good coverage with our unit tests, and that coverage is relevant, right? We are not talking about fake coverage.
Okay.
Do we still need other types of testing like automation or manual?
Well, yeah, in my experience, you do, because no matter how good your coverage is, you want to be able to cover all your test cases. We actually have, in my current team, we actually have this rule of thumb that for each bug the manual testing finds out, when we fix it, we also write a unit test for that case, because we missed it when we wrote our initial unit tests. So yeah, I would say that other types of testing are very important, and you shouldn't rely only on unit tests or only on functional tests or something like that. You always have to test the user perspective. Right.
Great answer, Stevie. Thank you for sharing your experience with us.
Thank you, Peter.
So I will let you now to just send us some final thoughts on relating to tests to the presentation itself.
Some final thoughts on? Sorry, I couldn't hear you.
Yeah, some final thoughts on the things that we presented past today. So like a conclusion for us.
Okay. So... first of all, thank you for staying until the end of this presentation and until the Q&A session. Now, I've added to my final slide over here some React unit test tutorials and some test-driven tutorial. I mentioned test-driven development right at the beginning of the presentation. As I said, it's nothing that you could easily do. Some projects don't actually qualify for test development, and some teams don't. But my advice to you is to try it and see if the goal over here is to actually use test-driven development, because it's way better to think of all the tests before you write your code. So that's why I've added that tutorial over here. Also, if you guys want to keep in touch, you'll find me on LinkedIn and on my GitHub account. So thank you very much, guys. It's been a pleasure for me to present my thoughts on booze and on testing. So have a great day, guys.
Okay, thank you one more time, TB, for this great presentation. For the rest of the day, I will let you in very good hands with a new host, Radu, that is one of my colleagues from the Web Community Leadership. So thank you. It was an honor and a pleasure to be here with you at this great event and enjoy the rest of the day. Thank you one more time. You will see with Radu and Gabi after a short break. See you.